dream of the good beginning. I know it's true, Daystar, we can't begin at the dawn of the world. We know this, and yet we persist in trying to start there, in the beginning, as if compelled by an ethical imperative, by a trauma, by an old grief, by perfect joy, fully experienced once, half remembered now, by all we think we know how to know. To begin at the beginning, as if it existed, as if it could be located like a lost key and dropped into a pocket for safekeeping. This persistent failure of imagination, a failure to draw together, tesseract-like, the precarious present with the good beginning of our fondest dreams, siren song and error. This failure of imagination is an echo that won't die. We make of it an exile and a light in exile, and as with other deathless things, hold it fast when it illuminates and also when it scorches, molten and extremely burning. The purpose of this observation can't be to excoriate the longing for a better world as a childish fantasy. We have all been children in this sense, and may still be or again. Nor can the idea be a binary choice between, on one hand, looking cold, hard facts in the face, and on the other, retreating into the poisonous warmth of a speculative nostalgia for some free-floating good life or heroic protest severed from the historical past. The point is elsewhere. To understand our uses for a special case of imaginative failure that is gone by many names, and will probably acquire a few more aliases before the time is out. The Golden Age. A hypothesis. Failures of imagination can sometimes speak where their successful brethren, limited to the horizons of the fields we know, fall silent. The point is to understand how the Golden Age works through its poetry, which I use in the oldest sense, the ancient Greek poiesis, the word for acts of making. Through its poetry and through its poetics, a term I use in its newer senses as a way of describing the operations of creative making and as a synonym for theory writ large. The point is to learn what we want when we think we want the Golden Age. Only then will we know anything like if, how, and when. The point is to change it. Two, an iron fatalism. What and when was, or is, or will be the Golden Age? For the Greeks, it was the primary stage of a mythic past. The poet Hesiod, that ancient misogynist, juxtaposed his tale of the Golden Age to the story of Pandora, saddled with her box of worldly sorrows, of which hope was last but not least. Hesiod was probably not the original source of this dubious gift, the Golden Age, but his poem, Works and Days, which dates to around 700 BCE, is one of our earliest written accounts of the story of the ages of man. In Hesiod, there are five ages, and the first of these is the Golden Age, in which, as Richard Lattimore translates the passage, mortal people lived as if they were gods, their hearts free from sorrow by themselves and without hard work or pain. No miserable old age came their way. When they died, it was as if they fell asleep. All goods were theirs. The fruitful grainland yielded its harvest to them of its own accord. This was great and abundant while they were at their pleasure. The Golden Age was one in which no work was necessary, and the end of days was a gentle slide into sleep. Moreover, according to Hesiod, the spirits of this first golden generation remain on the earth, like bodhisattvas, mantled in dark mist, bestowing wealth and defending mortal men from evil. The Golden Age, the poem tells us, was succeeded by the Silver Age, in which prolonged childhood and willful self-destruction. The Bronze Age, ceaseless war with weapons of bronze. The Heroic Age, demigods now gone to Elysium, undone by pursuit of glory or tragic necessity. And the Iron Age. This last age, the Age of Iron, is where Hesiod placed himself. And I wish that I were not any part of the fifth generation of men, he writes, but had died before it came or been born afterward. Works and Days is a poem for a grim age, a hymn of scarcity written in an ungolden era when famine and political unrest threatened the scattered agrarian cultures of Greece. Young city-states attempted to resolve this resource precarity by expanding trade routes and establishing colonial outposts abroad, often by means of extravagant violence. Hesiod's poem vocalizes this mood of scarcity in an address to his somewhat feckless brother Perseus, who has to be instructed how to settle down to the labors of farming, trade in the hollow ships, social reproduction, worship of the capricious gods, the laws of xenia or guest friendship, and even the right way to piss into a river. The poem's anxiety is for a world in which the strong exploit the weak, in which the hawk says to the spangle-necked nightingale spitted on its claw hooks, "What is the matter with you? Why scream? Your master has you. You shall go wherever I take you for all your singing." Why scream? Why sing indeed? How to call the time in which we find ourselves by its right name? For here now, Hesiod tells us, is the age of iron. Never by daytime will there be an end to hard work and pain, nor in the night to weariness, when the gods will send anxieties to trouble us. In response to this vicious world in which strength, rather than abstract principles of justice, determines who will eat and who will starve, who will live and who will die, Hesiod puts his faith, touchingly from a certain perspective, in labor. Labor performed in the proper way and at the right time. Dawn, says the poet, puts the yoke upon many oxen. And the 27th of the month is, among other things, the best day for hauling a fast ship with many locks down to the wine-blue waters. Works and days in this model will carry us the closest we can come to our flourishing, but the future is dark to us, bled of the promise of the golden ichor. The golden age in Hesiod is not a time that comes again. It's only later that poets will begin to speak of this imagined era as something you can return to, redeem, lose in your own right, gain in your own right, possess and possess again. Mist-cloaked elusives of the golden generation aside, though, Hesiod's Iron Age has nothing in it of the old gleaming. The golden age of works and days is rather a coping strategy, a way of treading water in the rough seas of the age of iron, an attempt to put aside the fantastical rumor of a time of infinite abundance in order to acclimate to one with exquisitely finite resources. In Hesiod, the work of coping is the best thing we can get out of a world whose potential for transformation lies not with humanity, but with the gods. The myth of the Golden Age imparts this signal lesson. Whatever we make of our austere circumstances, the terms of living in this world, according to Hesiod at least, stay the same, with exceptions only for the order of divine whim, an iron fatalism indeed. It's either very funny or very tragic, maybe both, to think of all this coming from a poet. 3, the young earth was too violent then for life. Ovid's Metamorphoses draws on Hesiod's narration of the Golden Age with some minor alterations for the context of Rome in the first century CE. The account in the Metamorphoses reduces the number of the ages of man from 5 to 4, omitting the heroic age, and adds this tantalizing detail at the dawn of the age of iron. Victa jacet pietas et virgo cade madentis, ultima caelestum terras astrea reliquit. Love, honor lay prone, defeated, and the maiden Astrea, last of immortals, abandoned the bloody earth. In other words, the Age of Iron is marked by the departure of Astrea, goddess of justice, last of the divinities who had remained on earth through ages of gold, silver, and bronze, who grows bored or contemptuous or censorious or wise, leaves in silence, at any rate, for warmer climes. Or maybe she goes missing in action, a casualty. There's an obvious allegory about the fall from an invented world of impartial operations in which we got exactly what we deserved. But our interest lies a little to the side of this allegory, which is why I'm not talking about Eden or Arcadia, and only a little about paradise and utopia. The character Henry Fool in the Hal Hartley film, Henry Fool. We know we have fallen because we know who we are. It is worth noting that this portentous claim, placed like a gem you could choke on in the mouth of a fool, is delivered to a poet called Simon Grimm, who will soon eclipse his would-be mentor. More about longed-for Astrea, unreliable international woman of mystery, a little later. At the American Museum of Natural History, a name that gives me great pain despite and because of my knowing the reasons for it, there's an instructive permanent exhibit at the Rose Center for Earth and Space, The Heilbrunn cosmic pathway, a spiraling ramp wrapped around a vaguely oblate spheroid that represents the universe's 13 billion year history. Each step along the path corresponds, according to the legend, to millions of years, and the age of humanity is depicted at the end of the pathway as the thickness of a single human hair. One of the placards on this instructive model affixed to the station that marks the time after Earth has assumed its material form, but before the planet has begun to quicken, reads something like, "The young Earth was too violent then for life." I'm shamefully working from recollection and may have regularized the meter of that caption a little bit. At any rate, the young Earth, too violent for life. Well, yes. And also no. Four, a golden catastrophe. One orientation towards the golden age is as a theoretical tool, and specifically a way of thinking through the problem of whether history has a shape, and if so, how to sketch that shape, sometimes descriptively, sometimes prolectically, and sometimes in uneasy mixture. In Marx's Grundrisse, the prelude to the more fully elaborated thought in Capital, the writing charts the stages of transformations of material conditions in Western Europe. Marx's theory of history is, in its aims and practical dimensions, precisely unlike the mythic accounts of the ages of man in Hesiod or Ovid, but it does in some ways unfurl in economic propositions what poetry has cocooned in allegory. We might, if we wanted to, call this an aspect of the peculiar poetry of Marxism. As he explains the origins of capitalism, not a natural and inevitable condition of our lives, but rather contingent and constructed, Marx dwells on a historical phase he identifies as late feudalism. Only in the period of the decline and the fall of the feudal system, but where it still struggles internally, he writes, as in England in the 14th and first half of the 15th centuries, is there a golden age for labor in the process of becoming emancipated? The golden age here is not something we can reclaim or long for in an unconflicted way. It is rather a missed opportunity, a counterfactual, a golden chance unrealized, a transitional moment where the material conditions of our lives might have been underwritten by some other logic than the private exchange of capital, but weren't. We can't inhabit that moment again, but we can learn from it something of the ways in which things might have been, might still be different. A passionate knowledge in that our delight in it might also be the most intense form of suffering. We can learn from this version of a golden age even without committing ourselves to the narrowest version of Marx's historical materialism that Walter Benjamin, writing from the vantage of the early 20th century, critiqued as pseudo-religious, robotic, like the 18th century automaton known as the Mechanical Turk, which could supposedly play chess like an angel, but was eventually revealed a self-fulfilling prophecy, as the puppet of a master chess player concealed in the mechanism's guts. Benjamin has sometimes been, in his turn, charged with a pernicious mysticism. In a letter responding to early drafts of the materials for Benjamin's unfinished Cosmophagic Arcades project, Adorno, Benjamin's friend and one of his closest interlocutors, cautions Benjamin against theorizing revolutionary rupture via the yearning forms of utopian wish images, a dreaming collective that might erase the difference between classes definitively. Adorno goes on to argue that the mythic archaic category of the Golden Age has had fateful consequences for the commodity category itself, although he admits that the crucial ambiguity of the Golden Age is underemphasized, particularly when it comes to the relationship between the Golden Age and hell and what modernity needs from both. For Adorno, the Golden Age is a concept which urgently requires theoretical elucidation and should not be left unexamined. We listen, Adorno, we listen. Indeed, in the schema for the Arcades project, sketchy indications as to Benjamin's plan for the finished work, there is this telling bit, number 7, dialectical schemata. Hell, golden age, keywords for hell, ennui, gambling, pauperism, a canon of this dialectic, fashion, the golden age as catastrophe. Susan Buck-Morse contends that Benjamin does not think that the mythic past gives us anything like a map of the future, and to believe that it could, as she writes, is purely utopian. Utopian is here a contemptuous term in line with the Marx-Engels critique of 19th century utopian socialism, particularly the American communal experiments of Owen Fourier and others, experiments that demonstrate the reckless absurdity of shellacking new technologies and modes of production with the shallow, premature version of revolutionary promise. Fourier, for example, an early, if irresponsible, theorist of climate change, painted an overheated picture of a world in which the polar caps would melt and flavor the seas like lemonade, and sharks and humans, in comradely fashion, would hunt the smaller fish together. In recurring to the imagery of a golden age dredged up thrashing and muddy from prehistorical past, the utopian socialists demonstrated how very much their time was out of joint. Technology is too young and too violent to realize imagination, and imagination is too young and too violent to march in lockstep with technology. This is a vital part of why the golden age can be nothing, as modernity conceives it, except catastrophe. And yet, for Benjamin, there is something worth lingering with in these fantasies, if only, as Buck-Morse speculates, that the fairy tale quality of the wish for happiness that they express presupposes an end to material scarcity and exploitative labor that form the structural core of societies based on class domination. Benjamin gives us that possibility, and also the following piece of gristle, a fragment of curtain raiser doggerel from 1832 to chew on, and oh, does it ever stick in the teeth. Yes, when all the world from Paris to China pays heed to your doctrine, O divine Saint-Simon, the glorious golden age will be reborn. Rivers will flow with chocolate and tea, sheep roasted whole will frisk on the plain, and sauteed pike will swim in the Seine. Fricasseed spinach will grow on the ground, garnished with crushed fried croutons. The trees will bring forth apple compotes, and farmers will harvest boots and coats. It will snow wine, it will rain chickens, and ducks cooked with turnips will fall from the sky. What can we rescue, if anything, from the wreckage of mere enlightenment? For no good reason, I think of the bit of Kant's categorical imperative that has always struck me as a potential piece of salvage, the one in which, if it could be managed, we arrange our social worlds so that we treat humans as ends in themselves and not as means to some other end. I think, too, drifting unforgivably on the undulation, of the shipwrecked Olivia at the beginning of Shakespeare's Twelfth Night, a comedy by God. Finding herself on an unknown shore and learning her twin has been lost at sea, she asks bitterly, "And what should I do in Illyria? My brother, he is in Elysium." 5. Conditions of necessary blankness. This place is not a place of honor. Under Grand Army Plaza, the ground beneath our feet, lies the dregs of the Revolutionary War era Battle of Brooklyn. Brooklyn, whose name derives possibly from the Dutch for broken land. And below that, what sadistic archaeologies, what bricks, what bones, what rainbows of beads the Lenape left behind them when they were forced off the land to the north and south and west. The American experiment, like colonial projects more generally, is founded as much on a curious ability to see in any given landscape a totalizing emptiness, a vessel without history waiting to be filled and named, regardless of what peoples or stories or languages or practices or flora or fauna already abide in that place. More properly, this is an inability to see, an inability to perform the function of seeing called recognition. But we'll let the verb stand for now. American utopian experimenters in communal living, from the Shakers to the Owenites to the Fourierists to the residents of Oneida and Brook Farm, were skilled in the arts of this particular form of unseeing, a brutal creativity whose end is the foundation of what we might call conditions of necessary blankness, a forgetting, a scraping down of the hide for a new palimpsest, a strange fashion of forsaking. Conditions of necessary blankness know a single monotonous song, but they sing it with great aptitude. Seize the means of the production of the future, and you have before you the white whale you've been hunting and the pan to fry it in. By this means, you can change the past. 6. Dusty heart-shaped velvet trays, The theorist Lauren Berlant posits in her consideration of American forms of the political an idea she calls cruel optimism, in which that which you desire is actually an obstacle to your flourishing. But to give up your longing would mean an insupportable dissolution of identity. So you stay with your fantasy of the good life, even as it threatens to kill you. This is as good a way as any of describing the kind of nostalgic vision of the Golden Age that sincerely believes that, bad as bear life is now, there is some skeleton key to the right way of doing things that we've somehow lost, just waiting in the gutter for someone to stop looking at the stars and pick it up and fit it to the lock and restore the balance of the world. This is the kind of paralytic position that, once recognized, can open into what Benjamin calls left melancholy, a comfortable arrangement in which we absentmindedly caress the empty spaces where in dusty heart-shaped velvet trays, the feelings, nature and love, enthusiasm and humanity once rested. A realism of the Golden Age, assuming we could learn to want that, would fully embrace neither a seamless pessimism nor an unexamined optimism. It is the worst kind of speciousness to ignore the probability that things can get better. It's speciousness of an equal badness to operate as if, because things can get better, it means that they also can't get worse, or just keep perpetuating themselves as a dim proliferation of relatively familiar trivialities of hope and despair. It's possible for the lenses you look through to get obscenely rude and rosy. It's also possible to get used to being the one that laughs but never wins. And both of these accommodations are much easier than holding the game of chance with its multiplicity of possible outcomes perpetually in the ethical mind, or the political one, or the aesthetic one, or, come to think of it, the poetic mind. No, of course you're right, though you're not right about everything, nor am I, thank God. That kind of golden realism would have to compass both fidelity to the world as it is and the knowledge that the attention and energy and care that goes into that fidelity can't be sustained at the highest pitch, at the greatest intensity, as an unbroken act of protest at every single moment of waking life. This realism would know that sometimes you need a break. Sometimes the best you can do might be to engage in what Annelise Francois calls recessive action, some kind of relationship to our inescapable knowledge that permits a release from the ethical imperative to act upon knowledge at any particular time or in any particular way or even at all. Sometimes the best you can do might be to attend to the much maligned world of appearance, as in the principled negation of Ray Torrado's Looking Away. Or maybe the best course of life would resemble somewhat Anahid Nersesian's Utopia Limited, in which utopia gets reinvented not as utter ruin or totalizing redemption, but via the reconstitution of the perfect world as a landscape in which resources are still, to some degree, scarce, and where adjusting to terms of grief, loss, suffering, and habits of self-denial by doing what we can to diminish our demands on our environments becomes essential to the idea of utopia per se. And maybe this kind of stipulated realism would be able to explain those days, as Frederick Jameson reports that someone or other once said, when it's easier to imagine the end of the world than the end of capitalism. So you give up for a moment and fantasize about what you'd do if you won the lottery. Where one form of imagination fails, another rushes in to stave off the horror of the void. It's not nature that abhors a vacuum. All that glisters is not gold. To gild refined gold, to paint the lily, to throw a perfume on the violet, to smooth the ice or add another hue into the rainbow, or with taper light to seek the beauteous eye of heaven to garnish, is wasteful and ridiculous excess. May God thy gold refine. 7, morning song. Like you, I'm mourning the late Ursula Le Guin. In an essay from 1982 that meditates on utopian potentials and failings, Le Guin writes that a persistent story about the Golden Age is that it is irrational, and unlike hyper-rational utopia, conditionally possible right here, right now. Meanwhile, she writes, it is of the very essence of the rational or Jovian utopia that it is not here and not now. It is made by the reaction of will and reason against, away from the here and now, and it is, as Moore said in naming it, nowhere. It is pure structure without content, pure model, goal. That is its virtue. Utopia is uninhabitable. As soon as we reach it, it ceases to be utopia. As evidence of this sad but ineluctable fact, may I point out that we, in this room, here and now, are inhabiting utopia. I'm sold on the Golden Age, on the idea that the Golden Age and Utopia are not interchangeable, but not entirely on the idea that one is mystical and the other reason maddened. The differences are both more and less profound. But maybe what Le Guin means is that there's a basic confusion at work here, as there must be in any act of translation. Maybe she means that Utopia is a no place that can, from one angle, look like the memory of the Golden Age projected onto the screen of the future. This would have to result, how otherwise, not in transparency, but in opacity. She's in search of a utopia we haven't imagined yet, one that divagates from the hard geometries of endless progress, expansion, automated logic without reference to material realities of lives as they're already lived. This was and is the matter of much of her fiction, an attempt to draw new geographies without extant histories, ones that did not, do not, pretend to conditions of necessary blankness. While she believed that the traumas of history don't die away from us, she also believed, more improbably, that history's joys and potentials can sometimes stay gold with us. The magic trick she works in her essay is this one. By alerting us to our arrival in Utopia, she causes the coast of Utopia to recede just far enough so that it's as if we never managed to make land, tantalized between the grapes and the pool of clear water, the devil and the deep blue sea. Every time we consciously realize that Utopia just might be here and now, we are immediately cast out of Utopia. It passes in our conscious experience from possibility to history or nostalgia without ever pausing in our present. Whether from Eden or the walls of the Republic, we have been in exile a long time and in strangely good company. 8, Dawn Song. Night's candles are burnt out. There's a form of poetry called an obad, a dawn song, or an alba, a form of poetry that comes from the Occitan French tradition of the troubadours. Its customary tropes have to do with adulterous lovers parting at dawn after the secret intimacy of a night together, regretting the separation and the arrival of the sun like they're in permanent exile from the earthly paradise. This is the silly, witty, sexy, importunate mode of John Donne in The Sun Rising, a mode you might not want in person, but which is very funny and very appealing and very effective in poetry. Busy old fool, unruly sun, it begins, and it ends with this. Thou, sun, art half as happy as we, in that the world's contracted thus. Thine age asks ease, and since thy duties be to warm the world that's done in warming, shine here to us, and thou art everywhere. This bed thy center is, these walls thy sphere. In other words, that old fool, the sun, has the wearisome task of traversing the whole world in order to disperse his gold in accordance with the necessities of day. Meanwhile, for the lovers in love, the world contracts to a manageable microcosm, no larger than the bed they share. And by the lover's great reckoning in a little room, love seems in that moment so expansive, so consuming, that it exhausts and contains all the possibilities of life within itself. The limits of the lover's bed become the limits of the universe. There are obvious reasons why Donne is much better as poetry or affect theory than as politics proper. Indeed, the 20th century poet Philip Larkin satirizes this gloriously solipsistic version of the alba in his own ironically named obad, in which the speaker lies awake, accompanied not by a lover, but by dread of dying and being dead, a special way of being afraid. When day returns, the cyclical movement offers only a conditional release from the acuteness of the fear of mortality, and significantly, the sun is nowhere in evidence. The sky is white as clay with no sun. Work has to be done, he writes. Postmen like doctors go from house to house. Labor and routine are not here, and it's oddly reminiscent of Hesiod in Works and Days, guarantors of a new golden age. They are rather the minimal conditions necessary for getting on with things, the movement from acute pain to a milder chronic variety of illness. If postmen, like doctors, have a kind of palliative remedy, perhaps it lies in social exchange, and specifically the transmission of that old Socratic pharmacon, poison and cure according to Plato, according to Derrida, the written word. Our failure to get over the Golden Age is worth contemplating, in part because one of its major uses seems to be, poetically speaking, a Janus face image. In one direction, an image of what we can recuperate. In the other, an image of what we have irrevocably lost. Oh, there's a terrifying innocence in my face, writes the poet Robert Lowell in a poem called History. a terrifying innocence in my face, drenched with the silver salvage of the morn frost. Although it's far from the only possible response, it strikes me as a reasonable answer, all told, to that rueful claim, we'll always have paradise. The problem of how to get from history to futurity without drowning the present along the way is one that a consideration of the Golden Age might help us to answer. In a poem nearly as overexposed as the Jeff Buckley version of Leonard Cohen's Hallelujah, Wallace Stevens asks the following questions. O thing men of Haddam, why do you imagine golden birds? Do you not see how the blackbird walks around the feet of the women about you? How, to put it in plain terms, do we keep from veering from this world into the world of imagination? And what happens if they fit together dialectically or don't? And what happens when we can no longer tell the difference? 9, letter to Estrella. Dear Estrella, I hope this finds you wherever you are, dear one. Youngest.
May I have your attention? The night of philosophy will be over in 30 minutes. I repeat, the night of philosophy will be over in 30 minutes.
Slipping in the side door and dissolving like a soap bubble the minute you're recognized. Was it you I saw at the party near dawn? There was a tender irony about your mouth, and I heard you being witty at your own expense. I think we were all a little in love with you, for which, of course, you're forgiven, and forgiven, too, for all your fleeting cameos in the good poems and the bad ones. I suppose you couldn't resist. This is presumptuous of me, but remember I never lived in the Golden Age and must be forgiven my iron heart, pitted by meteors and recrudescence of rust. Yours sometimes on colder mornings are. 10, nothing is settled. For so many of us, things have never been better. I know how grim that sounds. In the course of a somewhat misguided defense of Rousseau, the arch structuralist, Claude Lévi-Strauss writes this. If men have always been concerned with only one task, how to create a society fit to live in, the forces which inspired our distant ancestors are also present in us. Nothing is settled. Everything can still be altered. What was done but turned out wrong can be done again. The Golden Age, which blind superstition had placed behind or ahead of us, is in us. This is stirring rhetoric. Are you seduced? I'm seduced myself, I don't mind telling you, but I'm also suspicious. For if anything like the Golden Age is right, if anything like what I've been saying about the Golden Age is right, the idea that we carry it within us should convulse our bellies with laughter and rattle our bones with fear as much as it should lighten our hearts with hope. Don't say, won't get fooled again. You too have seen eclipses, though you've probably missed at least one transit of Venus. You too have stood a little longer than you should have in the chill shadow of the moon. To have done otherwise would have been, the first sin, undialectical. 11th hour, 11. Our time grows short, and the planet Venus is Lucifer, and Lucifer is the evening star, and the evening star is the morning star, and Hesperus is Phosphorus, and this is Hesperus wrecked, and this is Phosphor reading by her own light. Pandora-like, I wanted to end with a wiser sort of hoping. I wanted to give you a golden age that would do what you needed it to, or else a way of detaching from your longing definitively. I wanted to have earned the right to say, I have an object that shall startle you and make you know whither you are going. Of course, I have failed, but this is the 11th hour, and the signal virtue of an 11th hour is the arbitrary feeling that something new might even now be shimmering into being, even if we have yet to know what it is or how to speak its name. We have seen that one of the simplest ways to summon the Golden Age, a dangerous game, is to treat it as an object of prayer. We've seen, too, that one of the simplest ways to dispel the Golden Age, at least for a while, until it draws to itself anew its critical mass of glitter, is to tell ourselves it comes to the lure what we call. And so, this is the Golden Age, this is not the Golden Age. And so, good morning.